Greetings, villains, vigilantes, heroes, and heroines.
You're tuned in to Project SuperVillain. We're your hosts. I'm ArcDrifter.
I'm Killboss.
Welcome back to another Top 5. Month of March coming up, and you know what that means. We got more games to talk about. In fact, this year, I said this last video, and I think the one before that, this year has a lot of games
fucking
coming up.
Stacked,
it's,
dog.
Oof, it's going to be a lot. This one, this month in particular, I would say all six of our games, because the honorable mention, all six of them are pretty well AAA quality games, and they're all looking really good, honestly. So we're just going to have to hop into it, right?
Now.
Oh, by the way, welcome back.
Yeah, it's been a while. I wasn't around for a couple months. We were working on other stuff, and things were just too goddamn busy with the way the work goes and stuff around Christmas time. Anybody that's worked retail that time of year knows what's up. But now it's starting to quiet down, so we got time to focus on video games again.
So we're back, baby, and we're ready to jump into this video. So let's do it
now.
Number 5, Strangers of Paradise, Final Fantasy Origin.
That title's a fucking mouthful.
Yeah, it's also a little weird, you know? Like, it's just, like, off. Final Fantasy is supposed to be at the beginning of the game title, I feel like, you know?
You're feeling extra pretentious this time.
Yeah, so we're looking at an Origin title here, I guess, guys. So, it's coming out on the PS4, the PS5, the Xbox One, Series S, X, and on PC as well. And it's going to be out on March 18th. Developed by Square Enix, mainly, but they're going to be getting some help from Team Ninja and Koei Tecmo. Pretty notable. They're really good with their games typically, so that's some good star power to help out.
Mm-hmm.
But it's going to be published solely by Square Enix, of course. It's a Final Fantasy game. What'd you expect?
So this game, unlike a lot of the previous entries in the Final Fantasy series, except for the more recent ones, this one's actually a third-person hack-and-slash game, and it really goes balls deep on that. When you watch the gameplay, yeah, it looks a lot like Ninja Gaiden. You can even see Team Ninja's influence in there. It does blend some RPG elements in there as well, so I guess you could classify this as an action RPG. And it's supposed to be a retelling of the first Final Fantasy game, but it's like an alternate universe version of it. So they kind of don't really have any narrative constraints there, and supposedly there are a few different story elements to it.
It looks like Team Ninja has some influence in here for sure. Like, it's got an in-depth and robust combat system. Looks very nice. It features plenty of weapons and powers. Everything just looks like it flows really well together, so this collaboration between the two developers, or three developers, is looking like it's gonna be a good one. To use these weapons and powers on, we've got plenty of intimidating foes and bosses. Like, they look really awesome, some really well-designed enemies here. Definitely in Team Ninja style and spirit, so it's just continuing on with that. And again, it just looks like it's really good. Looks like a good time, honestly. We're not big Final Fantasy people here. Like, I have played a couple games, never admittedly have beaten one, but this one looks like one I'd like to play.
Yeah, same here. Never really been into the series, but if anything, this would make me want to try it out.
Well, you'll have to take a look at it yourself, maybe check out some more trailers and see what you think. Let us know down below if you're going to pick this game up, but let's move on to the next one.
Cool.
Number 4, Tiny Tina's Wonderlands.
So, we got Tiny Tina's Wonderlands, and that's like the next installment expansion of the Borderlands franchise. It looks like a hella good time. It actually looks a lot better than Borderlands 3 did, to tell you the truth. So we got that one coming out for PS4, PS5, Xbox Series S and X, Xbox One, and the PC on March 25th. Developed by Gearbox, as you should know by now, and published by 2K Games. So if anyone's played Tiny Tina's Assault on Dragon Keep, you'll know the game Bunkers and Badasses. Well, this is exactly what this game is based on right there. It's based on the Bunkers and Badasses game, which is basically Borderlands version of D&D. So it's basically a D&D campaign run by Tiny Tina, and during the length of this campaign, you are going to be visiting many different areas and biomes. Basically, just like all the other Borderlands games, you're going to have a bunch of super different areas to visit with different enemies in each one.
And featuring returning characters such as Mr. Torg and plenty of new characters to meet as well. There's a character creator as well. You can create your own unique characters with voice selection as well, which is pretty cool. I like that.
It's the first time we've seen that shit in Borderlands. Like, you was usually like pre-selected characters, but this time you get to totally create your own.
You get some more control over that, and that's really appreciated. There's 6 different classes to choose from as well to add to the customization aspects. It's a multi-classing feature. It allows you to use secondary skills along with your primary class. I'm not too sure exactly how it works though, so you should definitely look into that if you're interested. I'd definitely look into like a deep dive trailer if you want more information on that.
So for the first time ever in a Borderlands game too, we have equipable melee weapons. I know that every other character has had melee attacks in the past, but this time you can actually equip these melee weapons and come with their own damage effects and whatnot. You'll also be getting armor, rings, and spells to play around with. So the armor and the rings will buff your different skills and whatnot, either for just you, the player, or for the group. And the spells replace the grenades, and they just have all kinds of awesome effects on them. It's like raining down meteors, or it's lightning bolts, that kind of stuff. Maybe even siphoning health like some of the old grenades did. We still have yet to see how in-depth the spell system goes, but it looks dope.
Knowing Gearbox in the Borderlands universe, there's probably going to be a lot of different types of spells and stuff. I know, like in the last game even, Borderlands 3, they featured just hundreds of different weapons and different grenade types and stuff like that. So I imagine they're probably going to continue that pattern in this game as well. It's going to have this really cool feature as well. It's got an overworld map that's kind of reminding me of Super Mario World from back in the day. It kind of connects all the areas, and you walk around as like a chibi version of yourself. And yeah, it's hilarious because you just kind of like go to the levels that you want, like a classic game would be. But when you get to these levels, it kind of go into the first person mode again, and there's all sorts of different levels that have different enemies and different bosses and different stories that are all kind of separate to each other, which is really, really cool. It's kind of like different missions in a D&D.
Speaking of exploration, when you are wandering off the beaten path, there is a chance that you'll encounter random encounters. There are random enemies that you'll come up against where it'll teleport you to another battle area. You'll battle them, and then you'll get some loot. It's very akin to Pokemon.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it's like Pokemon surprise encounter.
Yeah.
Like, oh my god. Except you don't get to collect the Pokemon after, you just get some ass.
Yeah, when you get some loot, that's your Pokemon right there. Yeah, there your Pokemon's a gun.
Yeah.
It's a new dual monster.
Pokemon, it's a gun.
that's exactly.
Next, you know what, next generation of Pokemon, I wouldn't be surprised at this point. They're running out of ideas here, so.
Yeah, they're going to base one off a gun.
Surprise, just in a child's game. It's an M14.
So that's what we know right now for Tiny Tina's Wonderlands. We're going to move on to the next one.
Number 3, Kirby and the Forgotten Land.
Oh, yes.
Well, you better make sure you have a Nintendo Switch, because this game is a Switch exclusive, which, I mean, be surprised, it's Kirby. Developed by HAL Laboratory and published by Nintendo, this game is looking really cool, akin to Super Mario Odyssey. You're playing as Kirby this time in a big third-person world. It's awesome looking. This game looks amazing. Look at the trailer. Look at it right now. Look how awesome that looks. Very visually pleasing to look at.
So this is something that's a bit unexpected, but this game takes place in a vibrant yet post-apocalyptic world. I didn't expect to see Kirby and post-apocalypse together in the same sentence, but it actually works. Again, look at the trailer. You can see these levels look fantastic. All of these areas, I'm surprised they managed to nail this tone for a Kirby game.
So this is, as I said, a 3D world action-adventure game, essentially, but there's tons of platforming elements in there as well. One of the new features they've added to the game, it looks like, is called Mouthful Mode. There's plenty of memes about this, kind of disgusting ones. Don't look into it. Stop eating Pepsi. Stop becoming Pepsi. I don't know what you're doing. The Mouthful Mode is essentially something that Kirby can do. He's you've all known him for being able to suck up his enemies and copycat, like absorb their abilities and use it as a copycat move kind of thing. Well, that's essentially what this is, but he can do it now with an inanimate object. So if he finds your mom's dildo, you better watch out.
That's right. Kirby's gonna do some pegging tonight.
Oh no.
So yeah, if you can get past the fact that it's called Mouthful Mode, you'll find it's really useful for solving puzzles because you can turn into all different kinds of objects like cars and vending machines, even like road cones and stuff like that, and those are all useful for traversing or solving all the puzzles in the game. It's kind of weird, but I mean, they're like, hey, Kirby's been absorbing living things up until now, let's try some inanimate objects.
Copy abilities are still in the game. They actually change Kirby's abilities and appearance as they normally would, but there's evolutions to them now. So you can actually upgrade them and make them better, which is really cool. But definitely look into that if you're interested in this game. This game looks really cool. I actually really want to play it, which is not something I usually say about a Kirby game. That being said, let's move on to the next one.
Okay.
Number 2, Shadow Warrior 3.
Oh, I've been waiting a long time for this one. Shadow Warrior 3 finally has a release date. So Shadow Warrior 3 is coming out March 1st, and shockingly not for any of the newer hardware out there. It's only coming out for the PC, PS4, and Xbox One. So that's an interesting point, but it is still being developed by Flying Wild Hog and obviously published by one of our personal favorites, Devolver Digital. So, like the previous two games and even the predecessors before that way back in the 90s, these are first-person shooter hacking-slash-hybrid games, and I gotta say these new ones are doing a great job of balancing that. This time around, the combat in this one looks very, very similar to Doom. watch the trailer, you'll see exactly what I mean. One thing that I do like that they are changing this time around, too, is that instead of being a little bit of a duller, open-ended map design, they are going for more linear levels, so that'll provide better opportunities for pacing and a more handcrafted feel.
Oh yeah, we're looking at some refined Titanfall-esque platforming here. Wall running, grappling, it's really great to see because like that just adds that nice element to the game where the movement was, I feel like, the only thing that was missing from Shadow Warrior. So adding that in there is really nice. And it's also going to have new weapons with different functions and new upgrades to go with it. I mean, as you'd expect, it's a new game. They're not just going to stick with the exact same stuff. That would be kind of boring. So we're going to have different things with different mechanics. Looks like they have like gory kills as well. You were saying this is like Doom? Well, this is exactly like Doom here. A gory kill is so Doom. Just going in there and like cutting someone's head off right up close or doing some sick spin and cutting them in half. Do some crazy shit. I love that stuff, man. So it's good to see that stuff.
So not only that about the gory kills, but they also have what's called gore weapons. So after you do gory kill an enemy, you can actually rip off a part of their body and use it against the other enemies. So that was a point that I kind of forgot to mention, but I mean, that looks sick.
Yeah, that is so awesome. That's such a cool thing to add to the game. These guys are hilarious. The games are hilarious, by the way. If you've ever played a Shadow Warrior game, you know to expect, like, honestly, these are fun-ass games.
Yeah.
Definitely play them. The first two are probably really cheap.
The comedy is there, so yeah, check them out.
So in this one, progression's a little bit more linear. It's more controlled, with upgrades and equipment being given at specific points, accompanied by a very simple skill tree. So it's going to be taking a little bit of a change there.
Yeah, like you can upgrade your health and maybe stamina or certain damage percentages and things like that, but a lot of your main upgrades are going to come from you finding them throughout the story or them being given to you. Maybe there will be some light exploration too, but we don't know enough about it yet. Actually, they've been pretty quiet on revealing stuff for this game, so there is still a lot to learn about it, but we don't have long to wait. Again, coming out March 1st, so if you like these kinds of games, don't sleep on this one.
And you know what to expect. These guys have always consistently given us great games. So these are the kind of guys, like, I honestly don't say this much, but they're pretty trustable with pre-order and stuff like that, honestly. I wouldn't be too scared putting a pre-order down on this one because they're so consistent.
Yeah, so again, make sure you check that out if you're a fan of action games, but let's move on and check out our honorable mention before we get to number one.
It's the honorable mention, baby. Ooh, yeah. WWE 2K22. Ooh, yeah. Woo! Okay, so WWE 2K22. The first thing I want to state right off the bat is this game had a very, very hard time with the last release. It was complete crap. Everybody gave it shit.
It was shit.
We're hoping to move on with this one here. Now, it's coming out on Steam. It's also going to be out on the PS4 and 5, as well as the Xbox One and Series S and X. So, check it out. The updated graphics should hopefully do pretty well on these new consoles. It's going to be out March 11th, and it's developed by Visual Concepts, which is a notable change. They used to have Yuke's as their developer, but now it's Visual Concepts, and of course, it's still published by 2K Games.
Yeah, so it has been 2 years since we got a WWE game last, and that's probably a good thing, because again, 2K20 was not a game.
Big caca.
Yeah, it was. It was like, if you threw it in the toilet, it would look the exact same as a log. You wouldn't be able to tell the difference. They did promise big changes this time around. They promised it was going to hit different. We will see if that actually holds up, because just between you and me, I don't fucking trust 2K at all.
No, the only reason this is on the list actually is because I'm a big WWE game fan. Otherwise, there's actually other games out there that are good. So, but this one I wanted to talk about because I just happen to know a lot about it off the top of my head, honestly. So you hear me talking more than this guy over this one, honestly. But yeah. let's just go off on the things that are added to this game. Their first thing is a big one. They're adding a GM mode, which is probably one of the biggest highlights to a WWE game in a long time. This has been a requested mode since SmackDown vs. Raw 2008. It's been a long time since they've had it, and it's always been a fan favorite. So the fact that they're returning with it, hopefully it's not complete and utter garbage, because they're kind of spreading themselves out thin. You'll see what I mean when I start listing off all these different modes that they have in this game.
So one of the new features that they plan on adding is the unlimited reversal system, as well as block and dodge mechanics that are this time bound to different inputs. So you're not just pressing one button to do everything this time. They're going to make you think a little bit more when you're in the midst of a fight.
Kind of similar to some of the older games where it was a two-button system back then, where you had to block either strikes or grapples. But in this case, we've got a different system altogether. It's hopefully going to be good. I am honestly a little bit hesitant on it because I thought the system was pretty good before. It was a little clunky at times, I guess, but we'll see how this plays out.
Another thing that's kind of more of just a detail addition, but it's super appreciated, is the updated physics, as well as the weapons and items now that you'll be using in the arena will actually show their degradation before breaking, so you can get a visual cue about just how much use one of your weapons has left in it.
Yeah, they have updated physics and everything, but they're also making a big thing about the hair. The hair has not gotten much better, in my opinion. Yes, there are a couple of characters where the hair moves a lot, but no, they need to revamp the entire hair system because it all looks pretty fucking bad still, if you ask me. But that's just a hot take from ArcDrifter for you.
Fresh out the oven.
Yeah, to move on here, there's a showcase mode featuring Rey Mysterio. Big highlight for me. I love Rey Mysterio. He's been probably a fan favorite of everybody. Like, even people that don't watch wrestling know Rey Mysterio is, because it's just like, he's that masked wrestler guy, right?
Yeah. Yes. It's like awesome. How Kane stood out to people, too, for being the dude with the makeup.
Undertaker.
Yeah, or Sting.
Or Stone Cold Steve Austin. Yeah. You know, just, he's very popular, and he's had many awesome matches, and the showcase mode should feature some of the best ones, though I do hear it's mainly going to feature stuff from 2005 and onward, which is a little disappointing because he had a very good career before that. So that sucks a little bit, but we'll have to wait and see what exactly is coming out with it. I'm going to quickly run through the rest of it here. There's a My Rise mode that features a player-created superstar. So it's going to be like a solo player mode for your created guy. Has a female superstar mode as well, and also features different and unique storylines for each of them. Lastly, it's got an updated creation suite and an updated universe mode, different added features to them. If you want to learn more, definitely check out the trailers. Obviously, I'm a bit passionate about this game. I'm hoping it does well, but I'm holding my breath.
Because 2K.
But let's move on to our number one.
Number one, Ghostwire Tokyo.
Well, Ghostwire Tokyo. We've been waiting a while to see anything really about this game, and just now, shortly before release, we're getting a lot of information. One thing to note is that this is a timed console exclusive, so it's actually only coming to the PS5 as far as consoles go. It is coming to the PC, but Xbox users, sorry, you're just going to have to wait for a little while, unfortunately. That kind of sucks, but hey, that's the world we live in. It's coming out on March 25th, so we still got a bit of a wait to go from the time of this video's release, but it's coming soon enough. It is developed by Tango Gameworks and published by Bethesda. And Tango Gameworks is definitely one of my favorite studios, specifically because they have Shinji Mikami working for them, and that's the mastermind behind Resident Evil. You can't go wrong. So another shocking revelation that we found out while researching stuff for this video. This game was supposed to originally be the Evil Within 3. Now that's cool because I was like, you know, obviously Tango Gameworks, this game does feel a bit like the Evil Within when you look at it. It obviously plays entirely different, and that's why they decided to change it into something else, because it could just be its own IP by itself.
Well, hopefully a successful one, because honestly, right off the bat, just looking at it visually,
yeah,
I've been interested in this game since the beginning, since it started getting trailers for.
So, yeah.
And now that we're really close to release and seeing gameplay for it, it looks amazing.
Mm.
So you're playing as a detective possessed by a spirit. I guess there's more info on that once you actually play out how that happens. But essentially, they grant you supernatural powers that allows you to fuck up these enemies in Tokyo, which essentially, Tokyo is a little different right now. The population is completely vanished. No idea what happened to them, but it's your job to find out and to fix it. Using these powers that you just fucking obtained.
Yeah, unlike the Evil Within, this game is actually a first-person game. It has a similar style to a first-person shooter combat system, except you are using spells and other spiritual weapons to get the job done. You know, you have like a bow and a spectral shield, so you'll be putting a lot of these different weapons and spells that you'll encounter to use to defeat the spiritual adversaries. As well, there are stealth mechanics, which I honestly didn't really expect all that much, but that's actually kind of cool that they're giving you a few options with how you approach situations. When looking at the gameplay as well, it seems to really emphasize using combinations of attacks and your special abilities. I've noticed too, like that wire move, that looks really cool right there. Maybe that's the ghost wire. But yes, those sorts of attack combinations of different elements and different spells are definitely being emphasized, at least from what I can see in the gameplay trailers.
Oh yeah, you see like fire, lightning, and all these other things. Like, who knows, just all these different colors flashing in front of you too, like epilepsy warning.
Yeah, don't.
I don't think you can play this. Like, there's just so much flashing and cool colors going all over the place. It looks visually very pleasing. And I'm excited to see like what all these powers can do. There's multiple skill trees to upgrade, so there's even some sort of RPG mechanics to this game too, which is nice. And the last thing, which I'm really excited about, is the cat spirit vendors, baby! They're known as Nicomatas, and they sell you things. And look at that! They're fucking cute!
So you mean I can give cats money in this game? Well, fucking better take mine then.
I already give all my money to my cat at home, so I'm...
You just literally bring your checks home, you're like,
go master. goes to you. But yeah, no, it's really cute to see. It's a nice little touch. It's gonna be a factor that might bring people in, honestly. It's cats, man. Hell yeah. I'll try this horror game just because there's cat vendors in it. Why not? I mean, like, horror game, more like action horror, I guess. This is definitely more of an action game, I'd say, but definitely a lot of horror elements when you look at these enemies. Damn.
Yeah.
Those look really cool and intimidating.
It was funny, because we did think this was going to be survival horror the first time we saw the trailers it, but then, you know, you watch the gameplay, you're like, oh no, man, this is like fucking Devil May Cry with Skyrim spells. So yeah, that's Ghostwire Tokyo right there, coming out very, very soon, so keep your eyes open for that release, check out some trailers, and if you like it, definitely pick it up.
So, what was your favorite game that we talked about today? There's lots of awesome ones, and were there any that we missed? Make sure you comment down below and let us know. We'd love to have a conversation about it. But, that being said, if you guys liked what you saw here today and you want to see more, make sure you subscribe to the channel, make sure you like the video, it'll pop up in your notifications way more often if you have that shit liked. Trust me, the algorithm really likes that stuff.
To keep up to date with everything else going on in the Project SuperVillain world, make sure you check out all of our social media platforms. We've got Facebook, Twitter, and we also stream on Twitch every weekend on Thursday and Fridays. So check that shit out too. But that's enough for today, guys. We're going to get going here. Thank you for joining us. Thanks for watching.
Project dismissed. Peace out.